Good morning. I welcome all the participants to this webinar series about the course Automobile Design of 5th Semester Diploma in Automobile Engineering Program. The presenter for this webinar is Sri Sajikumar sir, who is working as a lecturer in Automobile Engineering at Government Polytechnic College Attingal. Today, the webinar is a continuation of the previous session, which is from the first module of the course. I welcome Sajikumar sir to this presentation. Handing over to Sajikumar sir.
Thank you. Dear students, good morning everyone. This is the second lecture on automobile design. In the last session, we have discussed to the portion inversion of a mechanism. During that session, we have discussed a lot of basic definitions like link, pair, kinematic pair, classification of pair, kinematic chain, constrained motions, mechanism, machine, and inversion of a mechanism. Definition of inversion of a mechanism. Today, in this session, we are going to discuss the remaining three topics of the first chapter. The topics to be discussed are inversion of four bar chain, inversion of single slider crank chain, and inversions of double slider crank chain. During the first session or previous session, we have studied that the kinematic chain is a combination of kinematic pairs, and each link forms a part of two pairs, and motion of each relative to other is definite. The detailed theory was already discussed in the last session. I am repeating the major points for getting a continuity, a kinematic chain. It is a combination of kinematic pairs. Each link forms a part of two pairs. And motion of each relative to other is definite. Here we can see the links are 1, 2, 3, and 4. The kinematic pairs are 1, 2, 2, 3, 3, 4, and 4, 1. 1, 2, 2, 3, 3, 4, and 4, 1. And each link forms a part of two pairs. Each link forms a part of two pairs. That means link 1 is a part of pairs 1 and 2 and 4 and 1. Similarly, link 2 is a part of pairs 1 and 2 and 2 and 3. Link 3 is a part of pairs 2 and 3 and 3 and 4. Similarly, link 4 is a part of pairs 3 and 4 and 4 and 1. Hence, this arrangement is a combination of kinematic pair. Each link forms a part of two pairs, and motion of each relative to other is definite. Hence, it is a kinematic chain. Okay. After that, we have studied the definition of mechanism. If one link of the kinematic chain is fixed, this arrangement or this kinematic chain is known as a mechanism. We also studied that the inversion is the method of obtaining different mechanisms by fixing different links of a kinematic chain. These are the various key points we have studied in the last webinar session. Now, today we are going to discuss some kinematic chains and their inversions. I mean some examples for the kinematic chains and their inversions. Important type of kinematic chains with the four kinematic pairs are: first one, four bar chain; second one, single slider crank chain; and the third one, double slider crank chain. First one, four bar chain; second one, single slider crank chain; and the third one, double slider crank chain. Let's start the discussion of a four-bar chain. Four-bar chain is the simplest type of kinematic chain. A four-bar chain contains four rigid links and four pins. It contains four rigid links and four pins. The pins are used for joining these links. After the joining process, the links forms a quadrilateral shape. In figure, it is clear. The rigid links are 1, 2, 3, and 4, which are joined by four pins, namely A, B, C, and D. After the joining of link, we have the quadrilateral ABCD, which is a kinematic chain, known as four-bar chain. Now, what about the characteristics of the formed pairs? Link 1 and 2 forms the first turning pair. Link 1 and 2 forms the first turning pair. Link 2 and 3 forms the second turning pair. Link 3 and 4 forms the third turning pair. And finally, link 4 and 1 forms the fourth turning pair. There is no other type of pairs like sliding pair, rolling pair, screw pair, or so-and-so in a four-bar chain. Here we have noted four links. The link which makes a complete revolution is known as crank. A link which makes a complete revolution is known as crank. The fixed link is known as frame. The link opposite to the frame is known as a coupler or connecting rod. And one more link is here, the fourth link. The fourth link may be in oscillatory or rotary motion. If the fourth link is in oscillatory motion, it is known as lever or rocker. If the fourth link is in oscillatory motion, it is termed as a rocker or lever. And if the fourth link is in rotary motion, it is considered as another crank of the mechanism. This is the basic of a four-bar chain. Four turning pairs are there. Turning pair 1 is link 1 and 2. Turning pair 2, link 2 and 3. Turning pair 3, link 3 and 4. Turning pair 4, link 4 and 1. Okay. Now we are starting the discussion on inversion of a four-bar chain. We have already stated that inversion is the method of obtaining different mechanism by fixing different links of a kinematic chain. Here we can see a four-bar chain which contains four links. That means we can obtain four mechanism by fixing each link at a time. Look at the figure. By fixing the link 1, we have the mechanism A. By fixing the link 1, we have the mechanism A. By fixing the link 2, we have the mechanism B. By fixing the link 3, we have the mechanism C. And finally, by fixing the link 4, we have the mechanism D. In short, by fixing one link of the four-bar chain at a time, we obtain four mechanism or inversions of the mechanism, which are A, B, C, D, A, B, C, and D. A obtained by fixing link 1, B obtained by fixing link 2, C obtained by fixing link 3, and finally D obtained by fixing link 4. Apart from this explanation, some points to be noted in case of four-bar chain are, here you can read three points. First point is that if the length of one of the link is greater than the sum of the length of the others, a four-bar mechanism is not possible. Length of one of the link greater than sum of the length of other three links, a mechanism is not possible. Second point is that for getting continuous relative motion between the two links, there must be a condition. The condition is that the sum of length of the shortest and the longest link must be less than the sum of length of remaining two links. This point is known as the Grashof's law for a four-bar mechanism. The third point is that one of the link or the shortest link should make a complete revolution relative to other three links. Otherwise, this mechanism is not a useful one. According to our curriculum, these three points are not that much important, but you must have these points in your mind for your future studies and research. Now we are going to discuss the application of this four-bar chain. Various applications are listed here, in which we have to discuss the first four: crank and lever mechanism, so no oscillatory motion; coupled wheels of a locomotive, double crank mechanism; Ackermann steering gear mechanism; beam engine, double crank mechanism; complete rotation of the crank and the follower; the pantograph, double lever mechanism, which is a copying mechanism. First application is crank and lever mechanism. Here, the four links of the mechanism are 1, 2, 3, and 4. Four links of the mechanism are 1, 2, 3, and 4. The link 1 is the fixed link, which is represented by AD. Link 1 is the fixed link, which is represented by AD. The link 2 is a crank, which is represented in the diagram as AB. Link 2 is a crank, which is represented as AB. The link 3 is a connector, which is represented by BC. And it is the connecting link between the link 2 and 4. Finally, 4 is a lever or follower, and is represented by CD. AD is fixed, AB is here, BC is here, and CD is the follower. This is two, link 2 is crank and link 4 is follower. As the link or link 2 or crank rotates with A as center, the link 4, which is the follower in this mechanism, oscillate from point C1 to CD. As the link 2 rotates, the followers 4 will oscillate from C1 to CD. Initial position of this mechanism is A, B, C, D. This is the initial position. A, B, C, D. Extreme left position is A, B2, C2, D. A, B2, C2, D is the extreme left position. And the extreme right position is A, B1, C1, D. Extreme right position, A, B1, C1, D. This is the theory behind the crank and the lever mechanism. As the crank AB rotates about A as center, as the link AB or link 2 rotates about point A, the follower 4 oscillate from C1 to C2. Follower oscillate from C1 to C2. As the crank AB rotates about A as center, the link 4, which is the follower, oscillate from point C1 to C2. This is the crank and lever mechanism. The second application listed here is the coupled wheels of a locomotive. This invention of four-bar chain is also known as double crank mechanism. It is very clear in the figure that this mechanism contains two cranks. This mechanism is used for transmitting rotary motion from one wheel to another wheel. used for transmitting the rotation from one wheel to other. Here also we can see four links. The link one is the fixed link and is represented here as AD. Link one is the fixed link and represented by AD. The link two is a crank and here it is represented as AB. Link two is a crank. The link three is a connector which connects the links two and four. This link is also known as coupling rod. Here it is represented as BC. The link 4 is the second crank, which is represented as DC. The most important point is about the dimension of the cranks. That is the length of the crank, AB and DC. Both the cranks are of equal in length. Both the cranks are of equal in length. This is the basic structure of a coupled wheel of locomotive. As the link 2 or crank 1 rotates, the link 4 or the crank 2 rotates simultaneously with the same RPM as there is a connecting link 3 between 2 and 4. Hence, the rotary motion is transmitted from one wheel to another wheel. This mechanism was used in steam locomotives, some diesel and electric locomotives, especially Voltron and Shunters. In short, a coupling rod connects the driving wheels of a locomotive and transfer the power to all wheels. Okay. The third application is Ackermann steering mechanism. Steering mechanism is basically adopted in the steering system of an automobile for establishing the direction control. General components of a steering mechanism are steering wheel, steering column, gearbox, a drop arm, drag link, tie rod, and knuckle arm. When the driver turns the steering wheel, the rotation of steering wheel is converted to the turning motion of wheel with the help of a mechanism. Generally, two types of steering mechanism are used in automobiles. They are Ackermann steering mechanism and Davis steering mechanism. Here we are going to discuss the details of an Ackermann steering mechanism. Okay, Ackermann steering mechanism is a four bar chain. That means it contains four links, which leads to four kinematic pairs. And it is a kinematic chain with a definite relative motion of links. Let me list the links of an Ackermann steering mechanism. First one is a cross link CD. It is also known as track rod or cross tie or steering tie rod. Okay, CD. Here we can see two short arms and two short axles. Two short arms. AC and BD. Two short arms are AC and BD, also known as track arm or knuckle arm. Two short axles AL and BM. Two short axles AL and BM, which is also known as stub axles. Short arm AC and short axle AL forms a bell crank lever LAC. Short arm AC and short axle AL forms a bell crank lever LAC. Short arm BD, here it is BD. Short arm BD and short axle BM forms another bell crank lever MBD. DB and BM forms MBD. Okay, that means short arm is an integral part of the stub axle. Hence, bell crank lever LAC is the second link and bell crank lever MBD is the third link. First link CD, second link LAC, third link MBD, and fourth link AB. Hence, ABCD forms a four bar mechanism. Suppose the wheel is running in straight direction. The cross link CD is parallel to the fixed link AB. While the wheel is running in straight direction, the cross link CD is parallel to AB. The short arm AC and BD, the short arm AC and BD both make an angle alpha. This is the alpha angle. Okay, hence we can achieve the straight direction. For the straight direction, AB must be parallel to CD. Okay. During the left or right steering, the links AC and BD makes individual angles for the correct steering. In the figure, the steering is for achieving right direction, moving to right. The fundamental equation for correct steering is cot phi minus cot theta equal to C by V, where C is the wheel track and V is the wheel base. It is track and it is wheel base. In order to satisfy the fundamental equation for correct steering, the links AC and BD are suitably proportioned and alpha should be suitably selected. Ackermann steering mechanism contains only turning pairs. And in case of Davis steering mechanism, it contains sliding pairs. We know the sliding pair has more friction than the turning pair. So the wear is more in Davis steering mechanism. So even though the Ackermann steering is not mathematically accurate, it is preferred to the Davis steering mechanism. This is all about Ackermann steering mechanism. All are turning pairs. Turning pair ACAB, turning pair ACCD, turning pair CDDB, and the turning pair DBBCA. Okay. This is the principle of Ackermann steering mechanism. Now, another example of four bar chain. It is a beam engine. A beam engine contains four links, which are a frame, crank, connector, and a lever or beam. It is the lever or beam. Here in the figure, link one is frame, link two is crank, link three is connector, and link four is lever or beam. It is lever or beam. In the figure, we can see two more links, which are piston rod and a piston. That means actually six links are there, but we can consider these links as the extension of the link four. See, the frame has two important points, namely A and D. The frame has two important points, A and D. A is the center point of the crank AB, and D is the point at which the beam is pivoted. A is the center point of the crank AB, and D is the point at which the beam is pivoted. Point B of the crank is point B of the crank is connected to the point C with the help of a link 3. That means as the crank rotates about the point A of the frame, the beam or lever oscillates about the point D. Now see the left end E of the beam. Left end E of the beam, it is connected to a piston rod, and the other end of the piston rod is connected to a piston inside the cylinder. These are the construction details of a beam engine. Okay, now the working. As the crank starts its rotation, the beam starts its oscillation. Oscillation of the beam operates the piston inside the cylinder, and we have the reciprocating motion of piston inside the cylinder. In short, a beam engine converts the rotary motion of the crank into the reciprocating motion of the piston. This mechanism is used to draw the water from the mines. different water pumps, oil rings, CE machines, and so on. Okay, we have completed the study of four inversions of four bar chain, which are crank and lever mechanism, coupled wheel of locomotive, Ackermann steering mechanism, and beam engine. Now the next session is single slider crank chain and its inversions. Basically, it is a modification of our four bar chain. Here also we can see four links. Link 1 is frame, link 2 is crank, link 3 is connecting rod, and link 4 is a slider. Link 1 is frame, link 2 is crank, link 3 is connecting rod, and link 4 is a slider. It contains four kinematic pairs. Here the pairs are 1 and 2, which is a turning pair. 1 and 2 is a turning pair. 2 and 3, which is another turning pair. 3 and 4, it is also a turning pair. And finally, 4 and 1, it is a sliding pair. That means a single slider crank chain contains three turning pairs and one sliding pair. Repeating the pairs involved in this crank chain, 1 and 2, which is a turning pair, 2 and 3, which is another turning pair, 3 and 4, another turning pair, and finally 4 and 1, which is a 4 and 1, is a sliding pair. Okay, this is single slider crank chain. Here is the list of inversions of single slider crank chain. First inversion. Here, link 1 is fixed one. This type of inversion is used in reciprocating engine and a reciprocating compressor. Second inversion, link 2 is the fixed link. This type of inversion is used in quick return motion mechanism. Third inversion, here link 3 is the fixed one. This type of inversion is used in oscillating cylinder engine and slotted lever mechanism. Fourth inversion, here link 4 is the fixed link. This type of inversion is used in hand pumps. Now we can discuss the first inversion. Here the link 1, that is frame, is fixed. Link 1 is fixed. Link 2 is a crank. Link 3 is a connecting rod, and link 4 is a slider. This type of inversion is used in reciprocating engines and reciprocating compressors. In case of reciprocating engine, the link 4 becomes driver. In case of reciprocating engines, this link 4 becomes the driver. And we know the link 4 is the slider or piston. As the slider or piston reciprocates inside the cylinder, we will get output from the crank or crankshaft. That is the rotation of crankshaft, which further transmitted to the wheels of automobile. In case of reciprocating compressor, link 2 becomes driver. The link 2, here it is a crank. As the crank rotates using the power of an electric motor, we will get the output from the piston. We will get the output from this piston. There is the reciprocating motion of piston in this compressor cylinder, and that motion of piston is used for compressing the air inside the cylinder. Okay, so this is the basic first inversion of the single slider crank chain, where link 1 is fixed, link 2 is crank, link 3 is connector, and link 4 is a slider. Okay. Next is, see, this is the second inversion of single slider crank chain. Here, the link 2 is fixed. Here, the link 2 is fixed. This is the detailed figure. And here, the link 2 is fixed. Link 3 is crank. This is the link 3, and here it is link 3, and link 3 is crank. Here, the link 3 along with the link 4 rotates about B. Link 3 along with the link 4, this is the link 4, rotates about point B. By doing so, link 1 rotates along with the slider at the same time slider reciprocate on link 1. By doing so, link 1 rotates. Here is the link 1 along with the slider at the same time slider reciprocate on the link 1. This inversion is used in the Whitworth quick return mechanism and a rotary engine. Now we will discuss the Whitworth quick return motion. This mechanism is used in general workshops to cut the metal. The forward stroke cuts the metal and takes a little more time. The return stroke is idle and it takes less time than the forward stroke. See in figure, link 2 is fixed. The link 3 along with the slider rotates in a circle with the center B. Due to this motion, link 1 rotates with the slider about A. Due to this motion, the link 1 rotates with the center as A. On the extension of link 1, this is the link 1 and this is the extension of link 1. There is a point D. On the extension of link 1, there is a point known as D. The cutting tool is connected to this point D using link 5. This is the cutting tool, and this cutting tool is connected to the extension of link 1, that is D, and this connection is with the help of link 5. Okay, the point D rotates in a circle about a point A. Point D rotates about the point A, and that circle is this one. Okay, consider the initial position, that is the slider is at C1. It is the initial position. The slider is at C1. Okay, the point D will be then at D1. The point D will be at point D1, and tool will be at E1. Tool will be at E1. That means the tool is at the extreme left position. The tool is at extreme left position. The condition, the slider is at C1 and D is at D1. Suppose the C1, the point C1 moves towards the C. The point C1 moves towards the C and finally reaches the point C2. The point D will be then at D2. The point D will be then at D2, and the tool will be at the point E2. Now the tool is at extreme right position. The time taken for the forward stroke of tool is proportional to the angle alpha. Here is the angle alpha. The time taken for the forward stroke is proportional to this angle alpha. Okay. Now the slider moves from C2 to C1. Now the slider moves from C2 to C1, which is the return stroke. The tools moves from E2 to E1. The time taken for the return stroke of tool is proportional to the angle beta. Here it is, beta, which is less than alpha. As the time of return stroke is less than the time of forward stroke, we will have the quick return motion. This is an important mechanism used in general workshop for cutting the metals with a less return stroke time. Now we are going to discuss the third invention of a single slider crank chain. Here the link 3 is fixed. This inversion is used in oscillating cylinder engine and a slotted lever mechanism. Here we are discussing about a crank and a slotted lever mechanism. Link 1 is a slider. This is the slider. Link 2 is a crank. This crank is rotating about point B. Link 3 is a fixed frame. This is the link 3 is a fixed frame. Link 4 is a slotted lever. This is the slotted lever link. The link 1 slides in the link 4. The link 1 is slider, which is slides in the link 4 or the slotted lever. The tool is connected to the point D. This is the tool, and this tool is connected to the point D of the slotted lever using the link 5. As the crank rotates, we will get the forward and retained stroke of tool. Here also, forward stroke is proportional to alpha. It is not visible. Alpha and retained stroke is proportional to beta. Alpha is larger value. That means the retained stroke takes lesser time than the forward stroke. This is the third invasion. Okay. Here is the working view of crank and slotted lever mechanism. Okay. Now we are coming to the fourth invasion of single slider crank chain. Here the link 4 is fixed. That means the slider of piston is fixed. Here the piston is fixed. Link 3 can oscillate about the fixed point C. It is the fixed point C, and link 3 can oscillate about this point. This motion makes end B of link 2 to oscillate about C. This motion makes end B of the link. Here is the link 2, and here is the end B, and it will oscillate about point C. Hence, the link 1 will reciprocate along the axis of fixed line 4. What is link 1? Link 1 is the cylinder. And with the help of these two valves, the link 1 cylinder reciprocate along the axis, vertical axis. This mechanism is used in ordinary hand pumps. Now we have completed the discussion of various inversions of single slider crank chain. Our next topic to be discussed is double slider crank chain. A double slider crank chain contains four links in which two are sliders or pistons. Here, two links are sliders or pistons. A double slider crank chain consists of four pairs. That means two turning pairs and two sliding pairs. Link 1 and 2 forms the first sliding pair. Link 4 and 1 forms the second sliding pair. Link 2 and 3 forms the first turning pair, and link 3 and 4 forms the second turning pair. The speciality of this arrangement is that two pairs of the same kind are adjacent. See, the sliding pairs 1 and 2 and 4 and 1 are adjacent. Turning pair 2 and 3 and 3 and 4 are also adjacent. This chain has three inversions. We have the first inversion if the link 1 is fixed. We have the second inversion if the link 2 or 4 is fixed. And we have the third inversion if the link 3 is fixed. Okay, we can discuss the three inversions and examples one by one. The first inversion of double slider crank chain. By fixing the link 1, we will get the first inversion. This inversion is used in elliptical trammel. The elliptical trammel is used for drawing the ellipses. See, this is the fixed link 1. This is a cross-shaped link. It is clear in the figure that the fixed link 1 has two straight grooves. This is the first groove and this is the second groove. Okay. This mechanism also contains two sliders. These sliders are connected using the link, a link 3. And C is the point on the extension of the link C. As the slider moves in the grooves, the point C on the link 3 will trace an ellipse. The point C on the link 3 will trace an ellipse. This is one example for the first inversion of double slider crank chain, where the fixed link is 1. Okay. Now we will discuss the second inversion of double slider crank chain. We will obtain a second inversion of double slider crank chain if we fix the link 2 or link 4. If we fix the link 2 or link 4, we will get the second inversion of a double slider crank chain. Here link 2 is fixed. And the end B of link 3 rotates about point A. The link 3 is here and end of the link 3, here it is B. Okay, the end B of the link 3 rotates about this point A. As a result, link 1, this is the link 1, it reciprocates in the horizontal direction. This mechanism is used in Schoch-Yoke mechanism. A Schoch-Yoke mechanism converts rotary motion to sliding motion. Okay. Now, the third inversion of a double slider crank chain. We have the third inversion if we fix the link 3. When link 3 is fixed, the link 1 is free to move. Slider 2 and 4 can turn about the point A and B. Sliders can turn about the pins A and B. If block A turns through an angle, the link 1 and block B must turn through the same angle. The link 1 and block B must turn through the same angle. This mechanism is adopted in Oldham's coupling. Okay. Oldham's coupling is used for connecting two parallel shafts when the distance between the two shafts is small. The two shafts have flanges at end. Here we can see the first flanger. This is the second flange. It is the first flange and it is the second flange. Flange A and flange B. The flange A is link 2. The flange A is link 2 and flange B is link 4. Both the links 2 and 4 contains diametrical slots. Here we can see the diametrical slots. Each of these links forms turning pairs with the link 3, which is link 3. Link 3 is the frame. That means link 2 and 3 forms a turning pair. Link 2 and link 3 forms a turning pair. And link 4 and link 3. Link 4 and link 3 forms another turning pair. In between these two links or flanges, that is 2 and 4, one intermediate link is there, namely link 1. This is the link 1. Okay, this circular intermediate link has two tanks, tank T1 and tank T2. And these tanks are right angles to each other. Link 1 can slide fit in the slots of the links 2 and 4. The link 1 or the intermediate link can slide fit in the slots of the link 2. This is the slot of link 2 and here it is the slot of link 4. When link 2 rotates, the link 1 and 4 rotates with the same angular velocity. This is the working of Oldham coupling. Okay, let me conclude this session here. This is the Oldham coupling. We have studied about four bar chain, crank and lever mechanism, coupled wheel of locomotive, Ackermann steering mechanism, beam engine. Then single slider crank chain, first inversion of single slider crank chain is reciprocating engine or reciprocating compressor. Second inversion of single slider crank chain is Whitworth quick return motion. third invasion, oscillating cylinder engine or crank and slotted lever mechanism. Fourth invasion of single slider crank engine is hand pump, in which we have discussed about a reciprocating engine, Whitworth quick return motion, crank and slotted lever mechanism and hand pump. Then about the double slider crank chain. The first invasion of double slider crank chain is elliptical trammel. The second invasion is Cauchy yoke mechanism, and the third invasion is old arm coupling. Now we have completed the first chapter of the first module of automobile design. Here are some questions based on the topic covered during this session. Explain four bar chain, list the inventions of four bar chain, explain crank and lever mechanism, explain the coupling rod mechanism, explain Ackermann steering mechanism, explain beam engine, explain single slider crank chain, explain the invention used in reciprocating steam engine mechanism, explain the Whitworth quick return mechanism, explain the crank and slotted lever mechanism, explain a double slider crank chain, explain the invention used in elliptical trammel, explain the invention used in Cauchy yoke mechanism, explain the invention used in old arm coupling. Prepare answers to the question listed here and discuss the same with your staff in charge. Okay, thank you.
So here concludes our today's session. Thank you, Sajid Kumar sir, and all the participants for participating in this webinar. Thank you.